Hello, everyone. What do you think of that album? My name's Arthur Baker, and we're going to do a little fireside chat between friends here. And basically, I love the album, and I'm really happy I do, because if I didn't, it would be really awkward talking about the album.
Well, knowing you, Arthur, you would have told us.
I would have
told us like it is. Yeah,
yeah, no, I would have. And no, I really think the album's great, and to me, it brings me back to Technique. It has the vibe to me of Technique and all the different layers of Technique, and a really good record, great record. But one question, why Tutti Frutti?
Well, I wrote the words to it, and it was pretty late at night, and I'd had a few glasses of wine to sort of help me concentrate, and then I could hear this, imagine in my head, this Italian guy enunciating over it. Well, do you know what that means?
Yeah, no, I totally get it.
You know what
it.
The word means, enunciate.
Yeah, like the rich in paradise.
Yeah.
These soft toast, the Italo thing.
Yeah. I don't know, I don't know where any of the lyrics
and,
come
and
from.
None of the band said anything to you about it? Or?
Do you like the title, Tutti Frutti? Steve, over to you.
It's a fine ice cream.
I thought it was about your favourite ice
also,
cream, actually. Was that not the idea?
It was a television programme in this country.
Now, have you thought about using it as a branding tie-in for an
ice
cream?
I'm still thinking
thing?
About it, yeah. Yeah, it's got potential.
No, the song's, surprisingly enough, it's not about ice cream.
Yeah.
I don't know,
it just sort of was the first thing I thought of asking you, you know?
Well, then it's a catchy title, isn't it?
It's you a great song. It. I love the song.
Thank you.
You should get Bobby Orlando to do a remix.
That's a good idea.
Isn't that a good idea?
We'll do that.
Get him out of retirement, man.
Yeah.
He's in. So, as the first album by the new formation of the band, how difficult was it to finish the record, and how difficult was it to get a direction on the record? Did you have a direction? Did you know what you wanted to do when you started making the record? Or
yeah, I think we decided that it was going to be more of a synth, dance-orientated album. You agree with that?
Yeah, definitely. We did make the decision. Because we wanted to do something lively up.
Did you guys
dance.
All agree? You all agreed on direction?
Yeah. We'd been doing the gigs, and we noticed that the dance bit of the set went down really well. We thought, it'd be good if we had a few more songs to put in the dance bit of the set.
So did you go off in groups and write together, or did you write, did you sort of...
Yeah, we did a bit of both.
Did you guys write together and...
And we wrote with Phil and Tom, and then we all sort of threw ideas in.
You what? I'm sorry?
We all sort of threw ideas in.
Yeah, we sort of split up naturally into a few groups, obviously Steve and Gilly, and then me and Tom ended up working together. Bernard loves working on his own.
Yeah,
because he doesn't have to answer to well.
We all know that.
Okay.
More wine for him.
Away from us lot.
Okay, well, let's get this right.
Just put it
let's
together.
Get this right.
Okay. Yeah.
You and Tom ended up living together. True or false?
You know, it's going through a hard time, Bernard. So let's not bring
I was calling him the odd couple, but they're not that odd, really. We kind of The idea was that there was, an imaginary hat on the table. If someone had an idea, they would throw it in the hat. And we did split off into different writing partnerships at this initial stage. And Steve's got a studio at his place, and Gillian, of course. And those two worked together. I worked on my own, which I think... There's a logical reason for that is that when I work on the vocals, I work on my own. So I've got used to working on my own.
Did you both? I read that you wrote all the lyrics on this album, right?
Yes, pretty I much. Did. Yeah.
And did you record your vocals at home, or did you?
Yeah.
I know how long it usually takes you to do vocals, so that would probably save you guys a lot of money, other than going to a studio.
Yeah, the rates you charge, yes. It saves us a lot of money. I'm quick these days, it'll probably take me a day and a half to write the vocal, and then 2 days to sing it and do backing vocals.
Wait, did you do the vocals at home, though?
I did them at home. It's a pretty crummy, unimpressive setup. It's just a small room, and I've got a little bookshelf that's made out of wood, and I just pinned my lyrics up on the bookshelf.
Is that the room that you played Dawn and I, those tracks?
It is, yeah. It's not very impressive, is it?
No, who was engineering for you on that?
A guy called Danny Davis engineered all my vocals and helped me with some of the synthesizer detail. And we tend to do, I think I'm right in saying this, we do a lot of the noisy stuff at Steve's, like those horrible drums.
Noisy.
The noisy drums.
Yeah. Bass and guitars.
Steve, did you play live drums on this record?
Yeah, yeah.
And then you cut them up, or did you leave them live as
work? Yeah, of course I cut it. Yeah. I massaged them, let's say.
Yeah.
Kobe beef sort of a massage.
Yeah. Cut price job it was, yeah. Very, very well
it was
executed.
Very cheap, those ones.
It was cheap.
We didn't really want to be around too much when Steve was recording his drums because we wanted to. Not that we don't like the sound of drums.
No. It's what's just not that
we,
to like?
We wanted to leave you to concentrate and get it just right. So we didn't hang around when you were actually making the kind of noise.
Jillian, did you sit on
I've been there before.
Did you sit in on the drum sessions?
I did, yeah, now and again.
Well, did you?
That was a lie.
Yeah. She wanted to, but due to family commitments, she couldn't be there. Yeah. Is that right, Jillian?
It is, yeah.
Jillian, how did it feel to be back in the band recording and making a record? Because you haven't really done a record together for a while, right?
No, it was a bit weird at first, obviously. But because we've been playing gigs for a couple of years, got to know everybody, and it was a lot easier. So, yeah, it was good.
Yeah, we got used to working together. We've actually been gigging or touring. We've not been on tour for three and a half years. We've been touring for three and a half years, which meant going away for 3 to 4 weeks in bursts and then coming back and having a bit of family life and a bit of writing and a bit of rehearsing.
I mean, how long did the process of making the record take?
Generally, you know, to kind of sum it up, it was done over two winters, 2013, 2014, and the winter of 2014, 2015. I think that's fairly accurate, with a bit of writing in between, you know.
What was the last track you guys recorded that made the album?
I think it was Superheated.
Superheated.
And that's the last song on the album.
Yeah.
Did you write that to be the last song on the album? Because lyrically, it has an ending type of thing. It seems like it, but
that was a track I think that we had to wrestle with the most because I'd had knocking around the backing track for a long time, and the verse actually went through three incarnations before I ended up with a verse that I had, and then we had to pin Brandon down, who's a bit of an elusive butterfly, and he was, you know, away on tour, and we actually recorded his vocals at the Manchester Arena. The Killers were playing there, and I guested with them on. They did a version of Crystal, which was great, and I guested with them, and we recorded his vocals in the dressing room afterwards, except the ones at the end that he recorded in Las Vegas.
And Stuart Price worked on that track?
Stuart did.
So he started it, or he helped finish
it? Well, he started it. He got Brandon to demo the chorus vocals, and then the demo sat around for ages because Brandon was away touring and we were away touring, so it was when our schedule permitted. And then Brandon recorded the vocals at the end and suggested we get Stuart to finish it, and which he did, and I think he did a great job of it. You know, it's a great track to end the record.
It's a great ending track, definitely. Yeah. It feels right as an ending track. Now, one of my favorite songs on the album is Academic. How did that come about? Whose music, or where did that music start?
I'd say Phil was responsible for that one.
It came from a little guitar riff I had, and then we just built it up around that, really. It's one of the more guitar-y tracks on the album. Some people like that, some people don't.
I really like it. I think it's a really good song. And I was wondering, who's playing the Neil Young lead at the end, that sort of... one note.
It's now, the only you chance to get to do a bit. On the
are you a Neil Young guitar? Because I know Neil, he's a Neil Young guitar fan. I think I've always assumed.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of all that stuff. So. Yeah,
but it was me on that track, Arthur. I played all the guitars.
Well, I actually.
No, it was Phil.
It sounded like, but it did sound like it could have been you.
It was
me trying to play like Bernard.
It was Phil's tribute to my guitar playing. Isn't that right, Phil?
Yes, Bernard.
No, it was
yes,
Phil.
Yes, Bernard.
Phil did all the guitar. I don't think I played any guitar. Yeah.
You didn't play any guitar on the record?
Did, yeah.
Yeah, on the record.
On the verse,
I played lead guitar at the end of the game, which was a track that Steve and Gillian started the game. Would you want to talk about the game?
Yeah.
You don't look like you want to talk about the game. Talk about the game.
Talk about the game, yeah.
Yeah, that actually started out as a very tender folk song, and then
a folk song.
Yeah, it was.
It got ruined.
A homage to Dory Previn.
I think I heard a mix that drops down to an acoustic guitar, maybe.
Yeah,
and then there's an extended mix somewhere.
Yeah, the extended mix of it is brilliant. It's really good.
Yeah, no, I Andy played me that.
That's right. Yeah.
Well, that's another track that we struggled with because actually Steve started it with a loop. And the loop was in like
in
the worst key possible to ever write a song in.
Right.
I don't know who wrote it in that key, but it had just a little chink.
So you just kept the key? Or you?
It just had a little chink of a guitar sound in the loop. Right. So Steve kept it in that key, and it was all like the black notes and all that stuff. So I think after 2 months of trying, we decided, why don't we drop the key down one semitone?
Yeah.
At which point, everything came
everything
very quickly.
Worked. Everything worked.
Yeah.
Now, what's the song with Iggy? You guys did the music. Was that? I read somewhere that the two of you started the
yeah,
the
that,
track.
Was, that was good.
That Stephen's
was, that. Well, thank you. That's my. I'm responsible.
That was your
my
idea.
Fault.
Yeah.
No arguing. No.
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 Every.
It was me. It was me.
It was one of us.
It was one of those Cliff Richards in the Shadows moments where we were working on it in the studio and Phil and Tom came in and said, that sounds good, I've got an idea for that.
Yeah.
And they did it. And then Bernard came in and said, that sounds good. It's perfect, just the way it is.
But the thing is, when being... I know you wrote a poem and Iggy Pop is performing on it, but the chords on it really sound like the Stooges. So did those chords come after?
Well,
did you throw chords...
Well, Steve Gillian started the track, and then Tom came along and played some bass
came
on it.
Along.
Phil played some guitar on the middle. Then I played a bit of like backwards sounding guitar on the middle because I'm a bit backwards. And then I did a little bit of piano on the middle. And then I thought it was, you know, we had it as an it was a good demo, you know, really really good. And then I wrote the poem. I was in lyric writing mode. And I was working on lyrics for about 2 months, and I just got exhausted one day and thought, right, I'll take a night off. It was like a Wednesday or Thursday something. And I just sat there watching TV with a glass of wine in one hand and with a computer here. And I just started... and what?
I said, be careful. Yeah. What in the other hand was...
Why are you suggesting, Philip?
Sorry.
So I wrote the poem... And then I did an Iggy impersonation on it that I hope never sees the light of day.
It was actually really good, that impersonation.
Yeah, well.
I sent it over to Iggy and said, hey, Iggy, how do you fancy, you know, having a go at this? And I just got a reply that said, hey, Bernard.
Hey, I love it, man.
It's Iggy. Sure, I can do this.
He does great messages on your phone message machine, you know? He's great at that.
So we sent it over to Miami, and Iggy recorded it in Miami, yeah.
And did you add more music, or that was pretty much
it? No, he sent me three vocals doing our Compton down to one. And then we kept the music pretty much as it was, except
we finished it.
Gillian's strings, we moved out of time a little bit. Oh, we put some live strings on it.
Yeah.
And then, and again, the extended version, the stripped down version, which is really good, don't you think? Yeah.
Oh, it's brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is he's happy with it?
Yes, he is. He likes it very much. Yeah.
That must be that must.
Yeah, he's not told me that, but I assume.
You can tell, can't you?
I'm not going to say no, am I?
OK. Okay, hold on here. So working with Tom from the Chemical Brothers, how did that work?
Because when we decided we were going to do something synthesizer-y, Tom was getting into production and we were just starting off, and it just seemed like it would be a perfect thing to do. He sent us some ideas that he'd been working on, one of which turned into Singularity. And he just came up to our place and we just worked on it together with him. And it was good.
Because you hadn't worked with him, but you had done a few vocals.
Yeah, I did a track with the Chemical Brothers, and with Bobby Gillespie sang on it as well, which shouldn't go unmentioned. The track was called Out of Control. And also, Tom produced a track for New Order called Here to Stay. So we were used to working with each other by remote control, really, at that stage. And it was nice to have Tom actually come up to Steve's studio and actually have him there in the flesh and bring in all his bits of gear. And he used a lot of Steve's equipment. Steve's got a lot of synthesizers. And Tom, it was nice to have him there and actually have someone in
place. He's really hands-on with the synths, Tom.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He is, yeah.
Now, I really like Unlearn This Hatred.
Yeah. That's an interesting...
That's a very cool track.
Yeah. Well, I'd written a song for a German band. I shall not mention their name, but they dwell here in Hamburg. And they rejected it. For some reason or other. I didn't write it with a view to using my voice on their record. I was writing it for them to use the vocal. And... for one reason or another, I don't know, maybe the key was wrong or something. They didn't use it. Or either because they thought
maybe
it was
they
shit.
Just, maybe they thought it was probably shit. Thought it was shit. And it was
so
it was pre-Tom's synthesizers, I assume.
Well, it was pretty fortunate that left us in a position which was a unique position for New Order, that we had a pretty good demo vocal that was finished, just the vocal. And so I thought it'd be interesting if we worked the other way around, because the normal way of working is that we write the music track and then I take that home and write the vocal. Well, this was the other way around, so I wrote the vocal.
So it was basically a remix of the song with all new music?
No, they didn't hear the music.
There was no music.
Yeah. There was no music. I just gave them the vocal.
It was a real challenge because, I mean, Bernard just sent the vocal over. We'd never heard the track.
So who, Tom?
Huh?
He sent it to you guys?
To us, the band.
Yeah. At Steve's studio, so we were presented with just a vocal with a BPM, and then we had to put some chords around that, you know, and it grew from there. So we were writing it in reverse, really.
Yeah, we did it.
And what did Tom, at what point did he come in on
then
that?
Then he came in later and did his thing, which is, you know, what we all love.
We thought it sounded very Detroit what he did to it. Mm-hmm. So he kind of Detroited it up and made
I love the synthesizers on that. That's probably my favorite synthesizer.
He turned on the synthesizer in the corner of the studio, but never gets used. And he said, we never use that one. He said, isn't this the one you did True Faith and all those? And he said, no, never use that ever. Ever use that one. And he just got this Detroit sound out of it.
Yeah, because the synth sound on that is amazing.
It is actually broken.
That's why it sounds good.
Yeah, because I fixed it. I said, I'll
and
get
now
it.
It sounds like shit.
And it doesn't sound any good at all. So I don't know how we're going to play that one.
But I mean, that sound-wise, that to me, that's the most sort of current synth sounds on the record. Like, there's a lot of other synth sounds that sort of are more sort of a little retro, but that seems real. It's a real tough synth sound.
That's what we liked about it. I thought it sounded very Detroit sort of techno sound, and we thought that sounded different to a lot of the other stuff on the album, and that sort of appealed to it for us.
Now, I was wondering, I know you're DJing now, so I was wondering, how often do you guys get out to clubs? And hear, like, sort of what's going on now in clubs, because it is very different than it used to be. Hearing a vocal in a club is not an often occurrence. You know, you don't hear vocals in clubs anymore. I mean, except for EDM. So you could have gone the EDM route, but, you know.
Yeah, it begs the question, why don't you hear vocals in clubs?
Well, it could be no one's making vocal records, club vocal records, which is probably the case.
Well, that begs the question, why is no one making club
because
vocal records?
Because DJs are making records and they don't sing, basically.
Well, that begs the question, why DJs are making records that they don't sing?
Because they can.
Well, that begs the question of why they've been put in a position where they can't.
You go out. You're a DJ now, so...
I can't sing. That's why I'm DJ. Okay,
Stefan. Exactly. DJ Stefan. Can't sing.
Steve, you can answer this one.
No, I'm saying when you're going out and you're hearing music, I guess before you play your set, you hear whoever's playing before you or after you. What's turning you on dance music?
Yeah, there's no singing in it. You're right. It's all... beats really, and some nice chords.
I'm going to get onto the musicians' union about this.
There's no verses and no choruses.
Putting people like me out of a job.
I know. I mean, I agree with you. It's terrible, absolutely terrible. That's why tonight I will just be playing verse and chorus songs. I'm playing Marlene Dietrich, a few Nico tracks. All the old stuff. Back to my roots.
I think the vocal gives you the human element, and you hear the human being. So, if we're in a position where we remove the human being, we're dehumanizing music, and that's not a good thing.
Okay.
Is it, Arthur?
That's a good answer.
Yeah.
But
you would say
if you want to have your records played in clubs,
listen,
you
know? Man, it'd make my job a lot easier if I didn't have to write any vocals. Yeah. So I'm down with it. You know.
Well, no, you only sample like a few words and go with that. But I mean, what I was going to say is, Technique was the Technique album was a classic of sort of that era, the dance era, when you'd go to clubs and you'd hear all those songs, and New Order was always known as a dance music group. And everything would get played in clubs, and it would be big moments of ecstasy. And when the vocals would come on, it was a big deal. Now that doesn't really, realistically, it doesn't really exist.
Well, we're going to change everything.
Right. Okay.
I've got an answer.
You know what?
I've got an answer for everything.
My point is, you were very ahead of your time with those records, and now this record feels like it fits in. Back then, when you made this record, you weren't particularly trying to make a modern record. You were trying to make a New Order record, I assume.
No, I think we shut all the doors, took all the phones off the hook, and isolated ourselves.
Yeah, that's what I meant. You weren't listening to anything else.
Well, we just did. No, we weren't. No, we just did what the fuck we wanted, and what we. I'm sorry for swearing. We did what we wanted, and. We did stuff that turned us on, which is what we've always done.
And what's very interesting about the record you made and the influences I hear on the record, the influences that you three had, back in the 80s.
I think...
The Chic influence on like Highline, which is one of my favorite songs. That's a great track. And I had a question for Tom, because obviously... You are the new guy playing bass, and obviously there was a sound that Peter Hook had that, it's in the room, obviously. But on a track like that, you're playing like Bernard Edwards, and you bring something to it that's very different, and it just gives it that track's my favorite because the bass on that's amazing.
I think that was the beauty of it, that we felt free. We didn't have to stick to an agenda with how the bass should sound. We could do whatever we wanted, and on that track, we just did a Bernard Edwards sort of bass line, and it just felt right,
Yeah, but I love that track. I mean, I think that's one of the best, my favorites on the record, but it is...
Funny you should mention that, because it is mine as well.
Yeah, because it is, it feels like Chic, and it has a house thing. I mean, the three or four songs, the dance songs that sort of come together, Plastic and where's my notes here? Singularity, Plastic, Tutti Frutti, and Highline. So those four are all the dance songs, and they're pretty much together on the record. Was that a conscious decision to sort of?
No, really. We tried. Steve. Had a big part, I think, in putting the running order together. He's very good at that, and you do that with a set sometimes, don't you? So
It just seemed that was the way it was. It just worked better that way. We tried moving them apart, and they were just like magnets. They just tutti frutti, just was attached to people on the higher line. I think no matter where you moved the other stuff, it never sounded right. But in that order, it kind of it's like a real.
No, I mean, I think the running order is really, really good, you know, because...
I think we put it together like a set. We would do a live set, right. And this album is geared towards playing live. I mean, that was a kind of brief we had at the beginning of our own that came from us, which was to, could you play the song live? If you can't play it live, if it wouldn't go down well live, let's leave that one and move on to another one. And that's paid dividends, I think. I think that's true of most of the songs on the album.
How many songs did you start for the album?
Not loads more. Maybe there's another kind of five ideas that fell by the wayside. Yeah.
Okay. Let me take a few questions from the internet here.
Okay. All right.
First one is Nick Farr on Twitter. The pairing of New Order and Mute is great, considering both your legacies and that of Daniel Miller. How did that happen?
Steve?
How did that happen? We needed a record company because we'd run out.
And just like Morrissey.
Sort of, yeah. Yeah, now you come to mention it.
Have you read his novel?
And his novel? Yeah, anyway. And I wanted to be back on an indie label. It just sort of felt right to go back on an indie label. And when the idea came up to go with Mute, it just seemed perfect. Because we've known Daniel for years.
I think what happened really was that the DNA of the band had changed for obvious reasons that we don't really want to pour over. The DNA of the band had changed. And therefore, we felt that the DNA of the... the label should have a certain synergy with that. So we were on Warners. Warners were great for us, and our back catalogue is still with Warners. But Mute came along, and it felt a bit more like Factory. And Miller's a kind of Tony Wilson kind of figure.
Did you want input from him? Because, he's a great music guy.
Oh,
so
yeah,
was that part of it also?
Steve?
Oh, no, Daniel was brilliant. He came up to the farm where we were working on stuff. He'd listen to what we were doing, say what he liked, say what happened to that track you played me last time. We didn't work on that. And he said, it was a good idea. No, he was really, really involved in the whole process of making it.
Well, it's good to have the guy who's running the label have been a record producer and has, some sort of input.
Yeah, you can't overestimate it.
It's nice to have a deadline as well, isn't it? Otherwise, if left to our own devices, we may have still...
You'd still be in there.
Working on Wavy Bernard,
still be at it.
Without Daniel there, you would still be making the record.
Well,
here's an interesting story.
There's absolutely no way. The first meeting we had with Daniel, I used the quote as a friend of mine here, Carl Bartos, who used to be in Kraftwerk, and he once told me, Bernard, creativity, it starts with a deadline. And I thought that was...
And ends with a deadline.
I thought that sounds good. Yeah. It sounds good.
Yeah.
So at the first meeting we had with Daniel, I said, Daniel, creativity starts with a deadline. And he was like, okay, so he gave us a deadline. Yeah. Which nearly killed us, it nearly killed us, the deadline. I think the deadline was really, if you don't finish it by this date, then the album doesn't come out.
You can't do it until next year.
You can't do it until next year. Yeah. So there was a logic behind it.
Yeah.
But I wish I'd never said that to him. I wish Carl had never said that to me.
The other good deadline thing is running out of money when you have to rent studios, because then...
Yeah,
but nowadays that's gone because everyone has their own studio.
Yeah, you can get hooked up in perfection though because it used to cost like €1,000 a day or something to be in a recording studio, and it was times money element to it. Well, nowadays everyone's got their own
Real
studios.
World?
Yeah, I
Real
do
World?
Remember Real World.
You should own Real World by now. You know?
Yeah. I'm sure.
Okay, another question, Bobby Clark from Facebook. Are there any modern electronic and synth artists that inspire you your music today? Gillian?
Well, Factory Floor come to mind.
I like Factory Floor. Who? Factory Floor. Yeah. Hot Chip, although they're not entirely synth band, they're good. Chemical Brothers, got to say that.
India Youth.
East India Youth, yeah, he's interesting.
I've seen him a couple of times.
Who's that?
India Youth.
East India
I like
Youth.
It.
East Indian Youth.
How about you guys?
I like stuff like M83 and Fortet, a little bit more eclectic sort of stuff, yeah.
I like an American band called Future Islands. I think they're really good.
I agree with everything
you don't listen to
just said.
You don't listen to anything, do you?
I think they're right in what they've just said.
When was the last time you went out to a club?
Listen,
I've just been really curious about that.
The last time,
not a pub, a club.
Well, it's an interesting story. I was in a club in Berlin, a few weeks ago, Berkheim in Berlin. But previous to that, I was in a club.
They let you in there?
I'm
surprised. Andy must have brought you in.
No, I was doing a talk there.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's...
Yeah. The last time I was in a club was in Berlin, previous to that, and I nearly got killed by our own record. I was on the dance floor dancing to some house music, and then they put Blue Monday on.
I was there that night.
You were there
You know how long ago that was?
Everybody.
That was like 15 years ago.
Okay,
though.
Well, 15 years ago.
And it was at Cookies, actually. It wasn't,
Cookies.
And
right? Yeah, I nearly broke my leg.
And you nearly broke your shin, yeah.
Yeah. They played Blue Monday, and everyone rushed the dance floor.
No, you rushed the dance floor. And then when you fell, everyone came to see if you're all right.
That's not the way I tell it, Arthur.
So
he's lying.
Do you guys listen to your... This is another question for me. Do you ever listen to your own music at home, ever?
No. No.
Do you?
No.
You can't
listen
to it.
No, sorry.
Do you listen to...
I tried to avoid it.
Do you listen to New Order records from before you were in the band?
Tom likes Morrissey, actually.
Yeah. Well.
You do?
From time to time.
Can you tell by the haircut?
To learn the parts in case you play them, or...?
For reference, yeah. And to check out the story and the history.
Because I was wondering, when you were making this record, you didn't reference any of your old tracks at all?
No, never.
No, we didn't.
Not even for sound or anything?
Couldn't stand it.
No,
because you've got to remember, once we finish a record, then we have to reorchestrate it for a band, and then we go out playing it live, and playing it, and playing it, and playing it. Last thing you want to do when you get home is listen to your own music. However, this record, we finished mixing it at the end of May, I think, am I right? Yeah? And then I took a break, absolutely needed a break by the end of it. I was totally stressed out, and... didn't play any music for 6 weeks, and then came back and played this record and listened to this record, and I thought, yeah, it's good. And normally, when you do that, you're kind of paranoid as hell, and you pull it to bits, and you're like, that could be better, that could be better, that could be better. Well, I did all that, but I thought, actually, it's pretty good. So I was very pleased with it, yeah.
So you are pleased, because usually you're never pleased with any of your records, usually.
No.
So you're not, like, doing overdubs in the mastering lab?
Well, it was interesting.
Because I know you've done it in the past.
Temptation, you mean, when I... when we mastered Temptation, I decided there wasn't enough reverb on it, so I got the mastering engineers to wheel in who had white lab coats in those days, wheel in a reverb unit and try putting reverb on it. There's a bit more to that story than I'm actually telling. I was best kept private. It's rather embarrassing. Yeah.
Okay.
Rob got rid of me rather quick. Yeah.
Let's take some more internet questions here. Joseph Schlack, what's the best or worst thing a fan has ever given you?
Oh dear.
Well, for me, it was drug related?
We talk about it.
As if. It was a painting of me naked. That was pretty bad. And if you're there, thank you very much. I appreciated the art. But,
Gillian, any love letters or anything like that? Or? From fans?
From Steve?
Never, no.
I get given a lot of tank books. I don't know why.
A what?
Tank books about tanks.
Books about tanks.
Yeah.
Military tanks.
And they're quite good. Daniel Johnson t-shirt. Nothing really. I don't think no one's ever given me anything that has been bad. No, I don't think so.
I got some salmon pink underpants from someone in Japan once. That was an interesting one.
Well, yeah.
Yeah.
Do you wear them much?
No.
Okay, an American TK on Twitter. Why do you think your music has remained so timeless after so many years?
Desperation, really. I don't think we have a plan B in life. I don't think there's anything else we could do apart from make music. If we stop making music, I think we might just die.
But I think the question is why has the music that you made remained listenable and timeless?
I don't know what the question is.
You don't know.
I'm trying to avoid the answer.
I think that's a good one for Gillian.
Gillian?
Yeah, I think you...
Yeah, well, I just think it's unique in a way. I mean, the way the band formed and the way we wrote everything and cared about the sleeves, cared about the songs, and I think that comes across. Pleased ourselves.
Yeah, it's also when we did it, like this one, we weren't really referencing anything else that was going on. So you were just writing good stuff that was outside everything else. And I think if a good song belongs.
But it's sort of making a record with your history and past in your being, you know, like basically all the influences you've had up until this point are going to
come out.
They're always there.
But we weren't trying to make a record that fitted in with the records that everybody else was making at that time.
That's clear in the record because it sounds.
I think that's a pertinent point that Steve's touched upon there, is that we've never been part of any movement. With Joy Division, we came just after punk, and we've never been part of any movement. We've always been out of phase with any movement that's come in. So we've never been associated with any movement. So when a movement occurs, it obviously has a shelf life. So, I mean, it's not something we've done on purpose, but just by luck, you know, we've never been part of any movement, so maybe that's why the music's
well. I mean, when the whole acid house thing came about in Ibiza and with the technique thing, it was, I guess, it was the timing that
we were more into enjoying ourselves, right. You know, being a punter than being a prophet, you know.
But you obviously at that point were going out to clubs a lot and really,
I believe we were, yeah.
Yeah. So at that point, you were probably influenced by what you were hearing in clubs.
Not to the extent where we could actually play any of it in the studio. We really liked going out to the clubs, but by the time we got back, you were just so addled.
Right.
You couldn't actually remember what it was that you liked.
I guess Fine Time came the closest to.
It was more trying to do something that captured the spirit of that rather than this was a good tune.
Yeah, no, that's what I meant. You were influenced by club.
You were influenced by a feeling.
At that point, you were influenced by it.
Yeah.
And now you're not really as much.
It was
much,
more, you know, I mean, like different... on technique, it was more just turning up and going to bed at 6 a.m. and then having bright lights streaming and just that kind of summerness of it rather than actually going to Amnesia and dancing like an idiot, although that was a large part.
I think at that point, the remixes were probably more important in a way because people would play vocal tracks with vocals.
And
a lot of your remixes, whether they were Shep, Pettibone, or a lot of the other remixes, were so right for the time, you know?
They were. We did have some great remixes. Yeah, some great remixes. But it's kind of sometimes when you listen to them now, they kind of have got they're pinned to a certain time. Some of them aren't. I mean, the Sly and Robbie one is forever associated with whenever it was that they did it. I've never.
What Sly? I've never heard.
Exactly.
Sly and Robbie did a remix of what?
Was it Ruined in a Day? Yeah, they did a remix of Ruined in a Day. I was off Republic.
Really?
Yeah.
Where is it? I love.
Exactly.
What? It was really bad.
Sly and Robbie are brilliant.
Yeah, they're brilliant, but
they're
remix,
really good.
But the remix really wasn't.
Yeah, It was just one of those things where that was kind of, you know, that was a kind of thing. Get Slow and Robbie to do a remix. It was tied to that time, and it kind of didn't work at all.
Okay, let me see another one of these great questions. Simon Tucker, 1979, from Twitter. What was it like working with Iggy Pop?
Well, we first got to work with Iggy. We did a concert. We got a letter from Philip Glass, the composer, and he said, we want two of you to come over and do a benefit concert at the Carnegie Hall in New York. And it's a spirit of collaboration, and the people that you can collaborate with are the National, the Patti Smith Band, Iggy Pop, Philip Glass himself, the Scorcio Quartet, and we want you to collaborate on a song or two. So there was a track off Lost Sirens called Californian Grass, and when we wrote it, the key was a little bit low for me. And I was sat home working on it. I thought, well, I can either get the band to re-record it in a higher key or could persevere with it. And I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll do an Iggy on it and pretend I'm Iggy Pop and do an Iggy-type vocal on it. Right. So when the chance of this collaboration came up, I thought, wow, I could send him Californian Grass and see if he wants to collaborate on that. So I sent it to Iggy, and Iggy went, yeah, I really love the song. It's in a really sweet key for me. But how about doing some more? So we ended up with him singing on Love Will Tear Us Apart and Transmission and Californian Grass at the Carnegie Hall. And Philip Glass played some piano on some as well. Wow. So it was quite a night.
Was that recorded? Is it?
I guess it's out on YouTube, yeah.
Oh, it is?
Yeah. And that's how we met Iggy. And then when I wrote the poem and had this beautiful piece of music that Stephen Gillian had written, I just thought I'd put the two and two together. And fortunately, Stephen Gillian couldn't be there in New York. So I thought this would be a great way of, you know, getting them involved. Yeah.
But you haven't really been, have you been in the studio with them or no?
No, Iggy recorded in Miami. Yeah. Unfortunately, I couldn't.
Why did you couldn't fly in for?
I was on a holiday.
Of course you were.
I was exhausted. I needed a holiday.
You were on your boat somewhere else
in the Caribbean, which is a long way away from from Miami.
Okay, from Marcel.
Have you ever been through Miami customs?
What's that?
Have you ever been through Miami customs and immigration?
I live in Miami, so yeah, I've been.
Yeah,
I've
well,
been.
You understand why I didn't want to go there.
Okay.
Although the rest of customs and immigration in the United States are all great, you know.
Fine. Yeah, it's just Miami. Yeah,
really
Miami's
nice.
Horrible. Yeah. Miami's horrible. It is. Okay, from Marcel Plum on Facebook, what would you think is your best album so far? Do you have a favorite song which was not a single?
For me, I mean, it's an individual question, I think, that to everyone. For me, it's this album, and People on the High Line is my favorite song.
Which one, Highline?
People on the Highline.
I've always liked Dream Attack.
You've always...
Dream Attack on Technique. Yeah. Yeah. I really like this album as well.
That's handy.
It's a good job, really, isn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, you do like this album, don't you, Jillian?
I do.
Steve, do you like this album?
Steve, what's your favourite album?
My favourite? Oh, this one, definitely. Definitely.
Okay, Phil?
Well, obviously this album, one. But I like Power, Corruption and Lies as well. I think that's a really top album.
And Tom?
I'm proud of the album we've just done, but my favourite album is Technique. I'm probably Vanishing Point.
Were you clubbing to Technique when it came out?
Technique is my favourite.
That's your club experience.
So I'm very proud that everybody's saying it's...
Yeah, no, it definitely feels like it feels in the same world as Technique, you know.
I agree with that, yeah.
You know?
I agree with that.
Now, would you like to have Nile Rodgers come and play on a track with you? Is that something you would like?
Yeah, I do. But not all the time, you know. There's a bit of that on.
Not to do a super group or anything, but just
Well, I like Chic. Who doesn't really? I think we're playing with Nile Rodgers, aren't we? We're playing with Sheik in Hong Kong.
There's talk of that, yes, playing with Sheik. Obviously not at the same time, but, yeah. Yeah. We'll be on one stage and they'll be on another probably.
So maybe we could get Nile Rodgers to get up and guest on People on the High Line.
We could too, yeah. Oh, yeah. No. There you go.
No.
If he's watching this, there you go.
Yeah.
Okay. This is a silly question. At 1000 Gig Guy from Twitter, who in the band was most keen to sing on the Baywatch set?
Who's the band was most keen to sing on it?
To sing on it. I would have thought it was you because of the beach and the bikinis and everything, but I don't know.
How dare you? I think it was my idea to do it, yeah, but everyone else was into it because we were... Top of the Pops wanted us to go on and do Regret, but we were touring America and they said, well, we'll do a satellite, a live satellite thing, where are you going to be? And we went, LA, and thought, well, what's the, you know, what sort of cultural export has LA had recently? And it was Baywatch. And David Hasselhoff was very keen to do...
he was a big fan. He knew. He even knew your B-sides, I'm sure.
He said, yeah, of course, yes. The more obscure stuff he knew.
Yeah, he was... Yeah. He had all the bootlegs of Joy Division, obviously. And...
Well, I've heard it said that David Hasselhoff wasn't actually there because it cuts away from him looking longingly out to sea, but he was there.
He was there?
Yeah, he was there. Yeah.
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 Okay, was it... Do you think he we were discussing, do you think he remembers that day very strongly?
Not as much as the Berlin Wall coming down, because he was responsible for the Berlin Wall coming down. So it paled into insignificance compared to that.
Yeah, it was his doing, yeah. I'm sure. Absolutely.
I love his LED coat on that. I was thinking of getting one myself.
You should. You should. Yeah. Suit you.
Yeah.
Is he still making records?
Tutti Frutti, it'd be good on that one.
Maybe he could do some covers of a New Order cover album.
Hasselhoff
does New Order.
I'm sure. What is David Hasselhoff up to at the moment? Gillian, do you
Gillian,
know?
You may
no
know.
Idea what he's doing.
No idea.
No.
I don't follow him.
He's probably somewhere in Germany at this point, though.
Probably, yeah.
Hey, he's a human being with needs just the same as us. He's trying to make a living in life. Leave that guy alone.
He was very nice.
Okay, another question from Facebook. Lou Bakes on Facebook. I have a question for Gillian. How does it feel to be back in the band, and what is your favorite song on Music Complete? I just really love the synths.
Well, I didn't do all the synths, actually.
Oh, okay.
My favorite song off Music Complete is I do like Stray Dog. But I like People on the High Line because I like Ellie from LaRue.
Yeah.
So, and I like the song as well.
It's a tough question, though, because I think it depends what mood you're in, doesn't it, really?
Well,
you
would think so, because there's 11 songs. 11? Is it 11?
Yeah.
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 Yeah. Steve, hey, we're not accountants.
I think you got to say what's your sort of two favorite songs, because basically they got to be two favorite songs. I'm sure. Like a dancey one and a rocky one.
I like Singularity. It's pretty dark and moody.
Right.
I
Steve?
Like that one.
Singularity and Tutti Frutti. I mean, Tutti Frutti just makes you smile.
Well, the title sure does.
The song does.
Well, I spoke to Johnny Marr the other day on the phone. And he said, tell me, is this true? Someone told me you've got a song called Tutti Frutti.
Who said this?
Johnny Marr. My two favourites are either People on the High Line and Tutti Frutti, or People on the High Line and Restless. I really, really like Restless, and I think that involves all the band, you know, all working together. And it sounds very effortless, and I really like the video for it as well.
There is a video.
Yeah, there's a great video for it. Really great.
I haven't seen it yet.
Oh, yeah.
La, 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 la.
Hey.
Oh, yeah, we're in Germany. Yeah.
Is that a hint?
Phil, a hint.
Phil, what's your favorite track on the album?
I think someone's trying to attract your attention.
Favorite two tracks.
Restless and Tutti Frutti, I think, yeah.
Okay, Tom?
Singularity and People on the High Line.
And Every Day is Like Sunday.
Yeah.
So is Highline, is that going to be a single, you think?
People on the High Line.
At some point.
I've been outvoted by the rest of the band, actually.
He likes it and you like it.
I know, but that's the vote.
Two out of five.
We're not saying never.
Hopefully it will come out as a single. Perhaps later on, Daniel Miller made a pertinent point that it's quite a summery sounding record, so maybe in the summer it would be great to bring it out, yeah.
Now, here's a question. Ellie Jackson LaRue, she's on a lot of the tracks.
Hi, Ellie. Yeah. Is it a question from her?
No. I'm throwing away the questions now. But because we're almost done. We're almost out of time. But how was she to work with? And do you like her music? Had you heard her music, or did you...
I have, and Gillian's a big fan as well, aren't you?
I am, yeah. I listened to a recent album, and I thought it was brilliant. So when we saw her, when she was supporting us, I thought she'd be a really good backing vocalist.
Would she go on tour with you? Do you think you'd ever do...
I'd like her to, yeah, but I don't know.
If you ever go on tour, I know you do these little...
Do a what?
These two-week... sort of trips.
2 weeks trips.
Well, it's actually
holidays.
They're actually vacations, and you do a few.
Listen,
it's work, man.
Compared to DJing, this is proper work, you know.
Yeah.
I could sing, play guitar, then DJ on the side with my little finger, no problem.
Yeah, I remember when you DJed, Barney. Yeah. It was not a pretty picture. I had to put the records on for you, and I was shit too. So, remember we did the Moby party. You remember that one?
I remember the next day as well. Ellie, she supported us in America. LaRue did, and they supported us in Santa Barbara and two shows in LA.
Oh, she did. Okay, so she already did that. All right.
Yeah. And we had a little after show party at the end of the LA gig, one of the LA gigs, and I just asked her, did she fancy singing on the album? Because I think me and Gillian stood at the side of the stage and someone else as well, and we watched the set and thought, yeah, she's really great. And I think she's really got it on stage as well. She's got a real stage presence. And she's quite feisty, and she's quite opinionated, and she talks a lot, but she got the vocals done like that, really quick, no trouble at all.
Would you guys write a song for her?
And I think her voice blends really well with my voice. I asked her to sing in a little chest voice rather than a head voice, and I think her voice really blends well with mine, so I was very pleased with the way it came out.
Would you guys write a song together, or have you sent her any tracks for her thing? Or
I think we're in touring mode now. I think we've had enough writing to, you know, for a bit.
No more writing?
No, it's too much like hard work.
The shutters
are... Unlike DJing.
I could hear her doing...
For now.
She could do covers of some of your songs, you know? I'm sure there's a few
songs.
She could do, but why would she do? Why wouldn't she?
She's got her own songs, yeah. Yeah, she could. It'd be interesting to hear her do one.
Okay.
Yeah.
I'm getting a signal from the side of the stage. I'd like to thank everybody. This has been great. And the album sounds great, as I said. There's plenty of tracks I'll be listening to again. And I guess that's it. We're done. Nice one, man.
Nice one.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.